Good evening. I've said good morning all day, like four times I've said it. Hey, I'm Amberly. I just joined staff here at First Jackson. First Baptist Jackson, August the 1st. So it's really exciting for me to just be able to say that. So I've been a member here for a long time, but it's really exciting to say that. But we're so excited that you're all here tonight. Y'all all, I think, got the email that Mel is in D.C. this week. She'll be back next week. But thank you for coming and joining our Bible study tonight. We have actually, Camilla is going to lead us in Bible study tonight. So I'm so excited. Camilla is on staff here. She's our Director of Assimilation and Social Media. And so Camilla and I get to work together on a daily basis. And it's so fun for me. I've really enjoyed her and her, just her joy for life and just what she brings to our church and what she's doing for the ministry here at First Baptist Jackson. But I wanted to just kind of open you up tonight and just say, you know, on Wednesday nights when we come together, we're in the heart of our week, the middle of our week. And my husband's been traveling this week. He left on Monday morning. He got home literally about 15 minutes ago and met us here at church. And we have four little ones. I have a 12-year-old, an 8-year-old, and twins that are 5. And so I've been, you know, mama to all four and working, which is new since they've been at school for me this week. And we've had baseball, and we've had swim meet, and we've had drum lessons, and we've had all kinds of things this week. And, you know, when we hit Wednesday night, I'm just shut already, and it's just midweek. And that's one of the things we have just really poured a lot of time into here at First Baptist, to say, what can we offer our people in the middle of the week to just come and really get a refreshing. And I was in the Sunday school class with some college students on Sunday morning, and they were wanting to do an icebreaker, and they were saying, what is the thing that really kind of get you talking with each other and enjoying the community that we get to offer with each other? And they were making each other talk about embarrassing moments, and I won't make y'all do that. But I did want to say, for me this week, I think I have probably not eaten supper any night this week. I fell asleep with a bowl of cereal by my bed last night after we got home from baseball at 10 o'clock. And I ate the food that someone brought up to this church today at 2 o'clock for lunch. And so today, this week, I'm sitting here saying, Lord, it's been a long week. And I was reminded in 1 Timothy, this is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. And for this we labor and we strive, and we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, and especially those who believe. Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, even though we may not want to stand up and read it, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given to you through the prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you, but be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and the hearers. And another version says, be absorbed in it. And I shared that with a friend earlier this week, because even in the mundane of our week, even in the crazy of our week, even in all that we're going through, if we can remember, and if we can live our life focused on the things that matter and be absorbed in them, then it is really so beneficial for us and anyone that we set an example to. And so that's why we put such an emphasis on our Wednesday night and trying to help you come to a time where we can really just come together in community and study the Scripture and revive ourselves to go through for the rest of our week until we get back together on Sunday to come back together to worship. So let's join together and let's pray for Camille as she comes to lead us in studying the scripture. So God's one. Lord, thank you so much for these ladies. Thank you for this church, for this community, for these people that we get to worship with. Lord, I just pray for each one of these ladies that have just, whatever their week has held and whatever they have come through to get here tonight, whatever crazy, whatever great, whatever good, whatever bad, whatever mundane, but Lord, thank you for bringing them here tonight. Lord, we just lift up Camille as she comes. Lord, speak through her and just allow us to focus on you for the next little bit so that we are renewed and refreshed in the middle of our week and we're able to go through until the next time that we're brought back together in worship for you. It's in your most holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
So I know we kind of already started, and my title is Director of Assimilation, but Chip told me this week I could change it to Director of Connections, because I was like, Chip, nobody knows what assimilation is. Anytime I say that, people just kind of stare at me, and it just sounds, it sounds like it involves math or something. It doesn't. So, connections, and I feel like as Director of Connections, I can't just start without, there are people in here who don't know each other. So I want to take 1 minute, and I know we're already seated, but this will be the only time you have to actually stand. You don't have to stand to read the scripture. So I want you to meet two people you've never met before. Tell them your name, and then tell them how long you have been at First Baptist Jackson. Okay, go. Well, see, apparently there's a lot of us who don't know each other in here. So did everybody meet somebody they don't know or they never met? I mean, that is so cool. And that's the part about being in such a large church. And we have our Sunday school classes, and then we have our, you know, our area that we sit in. We have our doors, that same doors that we come in every Sunday. A lot of times, you know, we stay in our same little groups, and we never even realize there's so many people we don't know. And as connections, dealing with connections, I feel like a lot of times the reason people kind of go unnoticed or fall through the cracks is because we aren't sure if they go here or not, so we don't say, hey, what's your name? And it might be their first Sunday, or it might be their 50th Sunday, and you don't know, so you kind of just say, hey, good to see you, you know, and it might be a first-time guest. So what we're really trying to do is kind of just create an environment where everybody's always taking initiative, connecting with people. If you don't know someone, just saying, hey, I haven't met you yet. And then they're like, we had lunch last week. If you're like, hey. Or, you know, when you meet your, it's already past the point where you can't ask somebody's name, but you never called it the first time. So you're at lunch with them and you're like, please say your name. Anybody ever been there? Okay, yeah, glad I'm not alone. But tonight I want to talk to you about just smiling. And I'm not talking about just a physical smile, even though I do think that's an important part about being a believer. I want to break it down. And I think that smile can really be what we're called to do as Christ followers. So I want to start out with the S. And as you see, my notes are very complex. So S, we are called to speak truth in love. To speak truth in love. You know, if we speak truth without love, we risk being hurtful. And if we speak love without truth, we risk being misleading. So we have to speak truth in love. And I think, you know, we really got to use wisdom in this. It's not always best to speak truth in love to your spouse in the moment when, you know, maybe you're really annoyed about something. That's not always the best time. Or maybe to a total stranger on Facebook that we've never met before, when they post something that upsets us, or maybe that's not the time to speak truth publicly. I'm talking about some very specific situations, but I do want to tell you a story. When I graduated from Mississippi College, I was a recruiter, and my territory was all of Texas. So I spent a lot of time in the airport, but I loved it. I loved it. I loved to travel, and my favorite thing was to people watch. So there was this one time, I was at the airport. I was going to be there for several hours. So I got one of the seats that faced the main aisle. So I got the best people watching. Yeah. Well, there was this lady who, she was like all the way across the airport. Well, she comes walking and she was beautiful, confident. Well, I noticed everybody was looking at her. And I thought, okay, this must be a celebrity. And I was always kind of wanting to meet somebody famous in an airport. And she gets closer. Well, then I noticed people are laughing. I'm like, okay. What is she? Is she trying to be funny? But she wasn't, so she kept walking. People are all whispering, laughing, talking. She's just smiling, like so happy to be flying wherever she's going. Well, then she gets about right here, and we make eye contact, and I just smiled at her, and she smiled at me, and I was like, what are they laughing at? Well, when she gets about right here, I notice she has one of those big toilet seat paper covers hanging out of the back of her pants. And I remember thinking, oh my goodness. So what do I do? Do I just kind of laugh with everyone else? Do I thank the Lord that it's not me? Or do I go tell the lady? Well, I knew I had to go tell her. So I hopped up and I went up to her and I said, hey, how are you doing? And I'm thinking, you're about to not be doing good. But she's like, I'm great, how are you? And I said, I'm great, but I just wanted to let you know, you have one of those, I mean, I don't even know what you call it, one of those toilet seat covered things hanging out in the back of your pants. And she said, please tell me you're kidding. And I said, no, I wish I was, but I'm not. But it happens to everybody all the time. And she's like, really? Does it? And I said, well, yeah, I'm sure it does. So anyway, she pulled it out of her pants. She threw it in the trash can, and she kept walking. And I was so embarrassed for her. But, you know, is that not life? And we have so many friends and so many opportunities, coworkers, family members, people in our D groups, our Sunday school classes, that we need to speak truth in love to. And it doesn't always feel good. It's not always just a happy conversation, but it's part of being a bold disciple of Christ, a bold woman of God. And so I think we have two opportunities to speak truth, and that's gonna be people within the body of Christ, and then people that God puts in our mission field. So we speak truth within the body of Christ, but then also the people that God places in front of us on our mission field. Actually, this is my passage. I wanted to read Ephesians 4. It's an entire passage, but I really want to read it all. I didn't think anyone would want to read 25 verses, so I'm just going to tackle this for us. But Ephesians 4, I'm going to read this passage. And this is really talking about us as First Baptist Jackson. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you are called to one hope when you are called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and he gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. So think about that person right now. Maybe it's your coworker, or someone in your D group, or Sunday school class, or family member, or your neighbor. Those people who just pour their hearts out to you and say all their marriage problems that they might be going through, or they're facing some financial decisions, or they're facing whatever it may be. You know, I know you have other friends in those same groups that may just say, girl, you do you, or girl, you follow your heart, or we see it, we hear it all the time. That's what the world says. Do what feels good. Do what's right. You know, do what you want to do. But that's not truth. We as women of God are called to speak truth in love. So I want you to be thinking about that person that you can begin to speak truth in. And it doesn't always feel good, like the woman in the airport, but I think that God calls us and holds us to that standard. And you know, that woman was thankful. In the moment, it was embarrassing, but as she kept walking, she was thankful that she didn't have that hanging out of the back of her pants. So we aren't, you know, it's not fair to just watch people self-destruct when we know that leads to death. That doesn't lead to good things. We know God, our creator, who loves us, who gives us his word to guide us, and also it's alive. It speaks through us. So when we speak God's word, it's not our words, it's not our opinion. So it really takes the pressure off of us. So as we memorize God's word and just share what he's already told us, it's really peace-giving, it's life-giving. Who has Galatians 6:1? Okay, could you read that, please?
Brethren, even if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself, so that you too will not be tempted.
And as we are abiding in the Holy Spirit and allowing Him to speak through us, there's a way to do that with gentleness. There's a way to do it where, you know, you're being kind and you're communicating it in a way that's not like, girl, you need to get your act together. There may be a point for that, but we draw people back to God's word with that gentleness, because aren't you thankful that God is gentle with us? And that's what I always have to remember when I am speaking truth to a friend. I've had a friend who has brought a marriage situation to me and said, the best solution is for me to leave him. And looking at the circumstances, that was not the best decision for her marriage. And so I had to gently say to her, look, God created marriage. He loves you. He has a plan for you. I know what you're going through is difficult, but I know that He's trustworthy and you can trust Him. Even though it does not make sense how this marriage could work, trust God, and He has the power to restore your marriage. And that's life-giving. The enemy wants her to believe the words of the world. If your marriage doesn't make you feel good, if your husband isn't leading you spiritually, if your husband isn't doing all these things, you need to leave him. That's the enemy. Even though it sounds right, because she said, my husband's not pointing me to God's word. He's not leading me. He's not good. Well, God says we're to stay committed. Love him. Pray for him. So I know I don't understand why or how or, you know, why God says a lot of the things he does, but I know he's good and he loves us. And you can know that too. So we can speak with authority and with power because we know our God. Who has 2 Timothy 2:15?
I do. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth.
It's kind of like having the secret cure for cancer, or, you know, having the hope that we know the world needs. We have God's word. And we have the freedom to hold it, to read it, to study it. And so when someone is struggling or dealing with something and we have this power that we can speak and we don't, it's kind of like, you know, I'm not sinning. It doesn't feel like I'm doing anything wrong. But it really is, if you think about it. If we have the power and we're commanded to speak that truth in love, then really, we're missing out on opportunities to share hope, to share life, to be an encouragement to someone. And the more you do it, the more, you know, less awkward it becomes, I think. Who has Luke 11:28?
He replied, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it.
So when our friends and family members hear God's word and they obey it, wow. Blessed are those people. But also, it's so important as we as disciples of Christ are being obedient to what we know. You know, instead of just preaching it, and then doing the opposite, I think preaching it, but also with our life. I don't think it's enough just to live a good life, because there's a lot of really good people out there. But when we are being disciples and loving and doing good things and maybe not watching certain things on Netflix, you know, you can watch anything, and I'm not doing those things, but just fleeing from sin, fleeing from evil, not wanting to have anything to do with just stuff that doesn't honor God. That's what sets us apart. And that's where people look at us and they say, okay, what's different? You know, you have a glow, you have a light. I want that. But it's not us. We know that apart from Jesus, we're nothing. We're sinful. I know that when I'm not in the Word and I'm not spending time with God, I have more of an attitude, or I just notice things in myself that I'm like, ugh, that's not like Christ. I don't want that. So let's continue on. And this is just a question I want you to think about maybe when you leave tonight. But why is it important to speak biblical truth and not your own opinion? So when you're in those situations, evaluating, okay, why is it important for me to speak biblical truth and not just my opinion? All right, let's move on to M. M is model Christ. And I couldn't decide if this one should be model Christ or make disciples, because I think those are two very important things. But in modeling Christ, we are making disciples, because that's what Jesus did, right? He was very adamant about making disciples. And that's how we see the world transformed, is through making disciples. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about making disciples in a minute, but who has Galatians 2:20?
I do. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
So, do you know what Jesus referred to himself, number one, the most in the New Testament as? The Son of Man, yes. But do you know, secondly, what he referred to himself most as? A servant. And I think so often I don't picture, I know Jesus was a servant, but when I picture him as God, King, you know. But he referred to himself secondly most as a servant. And that really puts things into perspective just as a believer and as a Christ follower, that it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives. And to really show the world Christ, it's putting ourselves, it's making ourselves servants and loving people in that way, serving people. We have so many serve opportunities here at FBJ. And I know what I have seen, it's a lot of the same people who serve in a lot of different ways. And I'm really excited, as Chip has been doing the sermon, Bigger Than Us, I think a lot of, I know I have really been convicted to know that, okay, God can accomplish way more than I could ever ask or imagine through me. But I have to be willing to come and show up and kind of and say, okay, God, here I am, use me. But can you imagine what First Baptist Jackson could do if everybody did that? If we all showed up every day, not just Sunday, not just Wednesday, but every morning, every single First Baptist Jackson member woke up and said, all right, Lord, here I am. I'm walking in surrender to you. I'm putting my life to death, and here I am. I mean, I feel like the whole world would change, because First Baptist Jackson, it's just a special place. It really is. I came here when I was at Mississippi College. I met Justin. We met online, but we met on the front steps at church to make sure that he wasn't like creepy. and he wasn't. We got married 5 months later. But so it worked out. But this is a special place, and I know God wants to use us, but it does take us showing up and surrendering ourselves and being servants and serving people. Somebody read Matthew 20:28.
Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Mm-hmm.
And then James 2:26.
As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead.
Right. So I'm so thankful that we're saved by grace, and that is how we're saved. But if we just have faith without works, that's also dead, especially to a world where, again, so many people do good things, but they don't do it in the name of Jesus. So how are we as Christ followers supposed to set ourselves apart? And I think that's doing good works in the name of Jesus. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the gospel right here. I said, you know, I'm thankful that we're saved by grace. And that's the beauty of the gospel. That's what sets Christianity apart from every other religion. You know, every other religion, you have to work to possibly work your way into heaven. You aren't even guaranteed that. And your good has to outweigh your bad. I mean, that, can you imagine how stressful that would be, living your life knowing that you could try to be perfect and then maybe not even make it to heaven? But the gospel, Jesus loved us so much that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And I know that a lot of us are really great at baking casseroles and doing good things for our neighbors, but if we're doing all of that without ever mentioning the gospel, without ever mentioning Jesus, that neighbor is just going to eat a good casserole, you know, and never know the hope that they can find in Jesus. And I think a lot of us, you know, we make that casserole because we might not know how to share the gospel. And just so you know, side note, the gospel, one of my favorite passages is Titus 3, and it starts at verse 3. I think it goes to verse 7, but it says, at one time, we too were foolish and disobedient, deceived and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures, living in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. That is the gospel. And, you know, Satan will keep us so paralyzed thinking, oh, you don't know all your verses. You might say something wrong. No, those are lies. Those are lies from the devil. He doesn't want that person to hear the hope they have in Jesus. And remember, like Chip says every Sunday, it is God's power that is working through us. So we're pointing people to Jesus through his word, through scripture memory. I mean, that took me like 4 days to memorize. And it was just, you know, saying it over and over again, saying it at night, reading it throughout the day. But it's the whole gospel. And so now I have it in my memory, and I can, if I have an opportunity, that's usually the passage I go to. Or John 3:16. I mean, there's so many ways to share the gospel. You can, there's actually a video of Jim Spikes walking the church through the three circles. So he and I sat down and we did a whole mock interview of if you were having coffee with somebody, how you would share the gospel with them. And it's so easy. You draw out the three circles. You ask them, you know, are you near from God or far from God? And they answer. And then you show how sin came in and it broke that relationship with God. And now the only way to restore that is through Jesus. And Jesus came. And now we can have a relationship with God through Jesus. It's very simple. But we have to speak it. We have to share that with people. So I did want to share that side note in case any of you maybe have wanted to share the gospel, but you weren't sure about how to share the gospel, because I never want to assume that, because it can be kind of a scary thing to share. I want you to think about this question too. What are some practical ways that we can model Christ in our day-to-day lives? All right, I. Insert yourself into people's lives. Insert yourself into people's lives. I'm not talking about the, you know, stereotypical Southern woman that shows up at her neighbor's house and it's like, well, I saw you through the window. What are you cooking over here? You know, I know that's kind of the reputation we as Mississippi women have. Sometimes we're all up in everything. But people want to be loved and people want to be pursued. And I know that's true. Even if someone acts like, no, I'm not interested. Leave a gift on their front porch with a note. Drop a note in the mail. Begin interceding for that person in prayer. You know, without them even know, just pray for them. And then send them a text to let them know you're praying for them. People want to be loved. There are a lot of people, even that I've talked to in our church, who are doing life totally alone. They don't necessarily want that, but it's all they know. They don't know how to make friends. You know, if you've been in a Sunday school class, you know, some of our classes can be very tight-knit. They're a solid group of people, and they're great classes. But if a new person is visiting, it can be intimidating. I've had several conversations of people who visited and said, I don't know anyone. I feel uncomfortable. And again, I hope y'all know I'm not saying anything negative about you. I'm just saying from these conversations I've had with visitors, it can feel intimidating. And our campus is large, and so someone visiting for the first time, just put yourself in their shoes. I mean, so they're doing life alone. They leave here. They go back to work. None of their work friends are Christians. You know, maybe their spouse is not even a believer. They feel alone. And we were created for community. That's why D groups are such a big part of who we are. And if you're not in a D group, we'd love for you to get in one. There are people who are still looking for D groups who are trying to find that community of people. And, you know, it can be hard. It really can. But if we don't have people who we're praying together with, who we're studying God's word with, who we have accountability with, then we just kind of go through life. And Sunday school classes, I think, they're great, but that's not really where you're going to just pour your heart out. You know, your D group is where you can say, this is what I'm struggling with. Can you pray for me? Or whatever it may be. So D groups are really important. But inserting yourself into people's lives, Revelation 3:20. Do I have Revelation 3:20? Okay.
Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and will dine with him and be with him. No, him with me.
Yeah, Jesus pursues us. And I'm so thankful for that. You know, relationships are not successful without any kind of effort. And I know Sunday mornings, I can be guilty of it too. I kind of go through my motions and get my coffee, and I mean, my job is to connect with people, so I kind of have, that's what I'm doing Sunday mornings. But for a lot of us, it's just a struggle to get our kids here on time, and then we're running to our Sunday school class, and then we run to church, and then we run to get our kids, and then we leave church, and then we go to lunch, and then we're like, oh, and we never even looked up to see if maybe there was a guest sitting next to us, you know, or was there somebody new in our Sunday school class today? Or so the point of church is that it's important, but we need to make it just kind of almost natural, like an instinct, where we're always looking for somebody that we don't know so that we can bring them into the family and love on them and take that initiative. And yeah, it can be hard when you're just trying to take care of your family. It's hard, but that's what we're called to do. It's to be a servant, to love people, to pull up an extra chair at lunch, or to maybe not take a nap on a Sunday because we spend longer at lunch with somebody who hasn't been able to share their struggles or pray with someone in a long time. That's what we're called to do. It's hard. And all getting into people's lives can be messy because you're kind of taking on extra stuff. One time in college, after college, I had a girl move in with me, and I was like, what have I done? You know, she was just coming to Mississippi College to look at the school, and then I just asked her, you know, if she knew Jesus, and then fast forward, there I was. And there are times when I'm in my flesh, I was like, I should have never asked that question, you know. But God began to work in her life. And then when I saw that, I was like, no, that's exactly what God wanted me to do. That was being obedient. The enemy wanted me to stay back, not ask questions, let her continue to go down that path that led to destruction. But because I just asked one question, she began to open up her heart to me. And then it began a relationship. And the last time we talked, she was plugged in at Pine Lake. And just really cool things happen when we do insert ourselves in people's lives. Not in an annoying way, but just a loving, kind way. 1 Thessalonians 5:14.
And we urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Mm-hmm.
Galatians 6:2.
Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ.
And Hebrews 10:24-25.
And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
You know, this verse is one that I've read a lot over the last year and a half, and it's kind of like, how do I read this in the middle of a pandemic? You know, I guess we are gathering online, but I think there comes a point when, you know, your friend who's not coming to church because of COVID, and then you run into them at the Mexican restaurant after, and they're like, how was church? You know, that's the point where I think, okay, we need to step back and really evaluate what we're doing here. Are we just not gathering because it's comfortable, it's easier, it's nice, it's to stay in my pajamas and drink my coffee and watch it online. I don't even have to go talk to anybody. But that's not what church is. Church is us gathering as the body of Christ. And I think when we're gathering in the body of Christ and we've been empowered by God's word and God's working in us and through us, we come and we have this fearless spirit about us, not a careless, not that we're, you know, we're saying, oh, you know, I don't care about COVID. No, we're being wise, but also we're bold. We know that God is our creator, our Father has us in his hands. And when we're coming to spur one another on. We're coming to help the weak. We're going to be patient with everyone. We're going to encourage one another. We need church. And the enemy has misled thousands of people to think, you don't need church. You're fine with just listening and watching and listening to the podcasts and all that. No, we need each other. We were made for community. And I'm so glad you're here tonight on a Wednesday in the middle of a busy week. Or when you come early on a Sunday morning and you're serving. And, you know, our kids and our grandchildren need to see that. Because the enemy's voice is only going to get louder. And there's only going to be more distractions. Things are never going to slow down anymore. Life is always going to be busy. And we do what we prioritize at the end of the day. And so we've got to prioritize church. Because it matters. And it matters in our lives. And us making an impact around the world. And then the last passage of this, 1 Peter 4, 8 through 11.
Above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen.
I love that. And, you know, the question for this that I want you to think about after is, who has God put in your life to pursue? I've always been kind of my spiritual gift is evangelism. I love sharing the gospel. And I know that comes easier for some people. For me, when I was on airplanes, when I was in the airports, when I was in random hotels or conferences, I always was looking for someone to just strike up a conversation and kind of always would figure out a natural way to bring up the gospel. That's just, kind of my gifting. And so, and again, I know that doesn't come easy for everyone, so I know that's a gifting, but that's where my strong point is. It's the part that comes after, the discipling, the investing, the time, the following up with. That's the part that's really, actually takes a lot of effort for me, because I'm good. I share the gospel. They confess their sins right there. We pray, Jesus is our Savior. I'm like, yes, awesome. Okay. And then it's like, all right, now, is there someone else that might could come and help disciple? Because that's a lot. But that's actually where discipling starts. Once somebody does make Jesus their Savior of their life, that's when they need someone to come alongside them and study God's word with, to teach them, what did Jesus do with his disciples? I mean, he did life with them, everything. And I wish so bad I could have done life with actual Jesus. Sometimes I picture him as serious, always just, but that wasn't Jesus. He was fun and funny, and all the guys together, I'm sure they would cut up and they had a good time and they enjoyed each other. But how cool that they got to see Jesus in all of those different moments, like how he would act with strangers. And I wish so bad I could have seen that. But when we share the gospel with people, or we have people that walk the aisle and make a decision and then they join our church, there have been some formal processes, but really our people are where need to come in right after that to say, okay, let's do dinner, let's do lunch, let's have a weekly phone call, whatever that means, to begin that discipling. And so I really want you to think about who God has put in your life. Maybe it's somebody in your Sunday school class. Maybe it's somebody younger. At one time, last year before Millie, I would always have three girls that I was pouring into. Some were in middle school, some were in college, some were in their 20s, but Millie she's almost two. I don't always have three, but I always at least try to have one or two girls that I'm consistently pouring into. And so if maybe you do have those girls, or maybe you don't. And if you don't, I want to challenge you to think about and ask God to bring you to someone to pour into. Because with all the distractions, with all the busyness, if we're just going through life, we're going to look back and think, who have I poured into? And I don't want that to be me. And that was actually one of my biggest fears. That's why I started doing, because I thought, this life is going by really fast. I do not want to look back and never have really poured into someone. Cool if I've made a lot of, shared the gospel a lot of times, but did those people ever grow, or did they just go back to their old ways? I want to make sure that I'm walking with people, and, when they're faced with decisions and they're a new believer, when I can share wisdom with maybe an experience that I've had, or they're going through loss or something, I can encourage them and pray for them. And so we're all called to do that, because there's a lot of middle schoolers, high schoolers, college students who still feel alone, even though they're in the youth group and they're plugged in. It would mean the world to them if an older, or just not older, I'm not saying they're old, a lady reached out to them and said, hey, I would like to take you to lunch. I would have loved that. And I was a preacher's kid, so I think a lot of people assumed maybe, oh, she's got her stuff together, but I really didn't. I mean, I kind of thought I did, but I would have loved it if more women in the church would have said, let me take you to lunch. You know, just share your heart with me. Let me pray for you. So we have a lot. I love that we're a multi-generational church here, and we have so many opportunities for that. And God's placed lots of younger women right here that we can reach out to. Okay, L, laugh. Proverbs 17:22.
A cheerful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones.
I love this. It's so simple, but joy, just being joyful. That is such a testimony of Jesus and what he's done in our lives. I went to, years ago, it wasn't even in this area, of a little bitty Baptist church, and the pews were filled, and I remember walking in, nobody said a single word to me. Everybody looked like, I was really thinking, did something happen? Everybody looked upset. That they're actually sitting in the last rows. The whole first of the church was totally empty. And there was just no joy in that church. And I, the whole time, was thinking, this is so sad. And I left that church just feeling sad because no one talked to me and because it just seemed sad. But, you know, in a world where people are pretty content with, you know, doing their own thing, partying, living life like they want, why in the world would they want that? You know what I mean? If they're having fun over here, living it up, and they look at us as Christians and we're just miserable, who would want that? So we need to exude joy. And you don't have to fake it. There are times where I feel sad and down, but then I get in God's word and I say, God, remind me of all that I have to be grateful for. Salvation, Jesus, the fact that I'm loved, the fact that you're going to meet every single one of my needs always. The fact that I get to spend eternity with you and I have a relationship with God, the Creator, and I can talk to Him. I mean, the most simple things can remind me of, I have no reason to just be, have an attitude or not smile. So I think that we just need to laugh and not take life too seriously and not take ourselves too seriously. And even in marriage, just laughing and in my experience, I've got 6 years under my belt now, so I have all the wisdom. I have learned a lot. I really have. My longest relationship before marriage was like 3 months, and then Justin and I got married after 5 months, and it was great. We had never had one argument, and everybody told me it was coming. I said, we're different. You don't understand. And I was wrong. We weren't different. But I learned, you know, what I have learned is just laughing and not taking things too seriously. If nobody does the dishes, they're just dishes. You know, they're going to get done. Or, you know, y'all know all this. I won't get into details. So anyway, so we and Christian, we need to laugh. We need to sing. We need to celebrate. And that's been kind of one sad thing about Sunday mornings, you know, not feeling the joy in the sanctuary like we usually do. But, you know, I think it's okay to sing, but don't say I said that. Can you put that out of the video? Okay. And lastly, E, embrace hardship. Embrace hardship. You know, it's inevitable. Life is hard. It's filled with sickness, death, heartbreaks, brokenness, broken families. I mean, we've seen over the last couple years, I feel like everything. It's just heaviness. But when we learn to embrace the hardship instead of spending our lives trying to run from it or, you know, keep ourselves protected from it, I think that is when we begin to experience God's faithfulness and His power and His grace in our lives. And when we experience that, that's so much more fulfilling than trying to isolate ourselves and protect ourselves from any kind of hardship. Just realizing we're going to face it. Being a Christian doesn't protect us anymore from hardship. In fact, it often makes things even more difficult, as if we're walking with Christ and we're boldly proclaiming the gospel and we're seeking to honor our spouse and we're doing everything, we're making disciples, you are a target for the enemy. So he's going to do anything he can to just try to make you miserable and to just say, you know what, I don't need God. But no, that's not true. God's power works in our weakness. And God, it's God's power that is at work within us. So a lot of times you see people going through these situations and you think, I do not know how they do that. Well, it is God's power that is working in them. And so I think a lot of times we don't really experience that grace or that power until we're in that moment. So it's really hard for us to know what it's like. But I know that whatever we face, we can trust God to give us that that strength. James 1, 2 through 4.
Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing.
So, who are some people in the Bible that faced hardship?
Job.
Job lost everything. Who else?
Paul.
Joseph. Joseph, that's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine? Sold into slavery, he was the favorite, and then they faked his death, and then, but the end of the story. Who else?
Naomi.
Yeah. Yes.
Moses.
Yep. Moses.
Jesus.
Yeah, I mean, I have a list. It's like everyone faces hardship, but mainly it brings us back to Jesus, our Savior, the one that we are modeling our lives after. Jesus himself was crucified. Perfect, holy, loving. I mean, the way he served and the way he loved and he healed, and he was crucified, hung on a cross. It really puts things into perspective. And for us to go through life and thinking, I didn't deserve for that to happen to me, or we don't deserve any good thing, actually, anything that happens to us. I mean, we're sinful people. Jesus was crucified and he was perfect. Colossians 3, 1 through 3.
Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God.
All these verses throughout, they're some of my favorite memory verses, and I would encourage you to, I know a lot of you have memorized a lot of these, they're very common verses, but to just memorize these verses. Because even this verse occasionally will come up in my mind, and I think, how often do I think about just earthly things? And we just moved into a new house, and I got convicted because I was spending so much time trying to figure out a paint color for my kitchen. And have you ever looked at a paint color sheet? You know, my sister-in-law went into a paint store and said she wanted just white. And then the guy was like, here's all your whites to choose from, and she's like, okay, that's just, I mean, it's overwhelming. And I spent so much time just thinking about kitchen color. And then this verse comes to mind, and set your mind not on earthly things, but things above. And the color of my kitchen, does that really matter in the grand scheme of things? I think we get so focused on all this stuff in life that it's not necessarily bad things, but sometimes I think the enemy uses it to keep us distracted from the main thing. The most important thing. And if we can really picture our lives and how short they are, it's really like a little stopwatch. We got like 3 seconds left in the end of the game, and sometimes we think, oh, life just goes on and on. I don't like to think about death, but sometimes I have to make myself sit and think about, okay, man, you're gonna die. It could be tonight, it could be 50 years from now, I don't know, but I'm gonna die. And so, you know, what am I going to do tonight? Am I going to spend time praying for people? Am I going to spend time maybe having a conversation with my neighbor about Jesus? Am I going to spend time reading God's word or pray? Or am I going to spend time watching a show on Netflix? And it's not always fun to do that, because sometimes it just feels good to just not have to think about anything, do anything, just watch a show. But again, we as Christ followers are called, I think, to something so much greater than a series that we get addicted to. Again, I'm not saying that that's necessarily wrong. I'm just trying to put things into perspective. We have a mission. People are searching for hope. They're lonely. They're dying without Jesus. And here we are with hope, with a powerful word to share. And the enemy keeps us distracted, or he keeps us focused on our hardships. He keeps us focused on our own problems, on our marriage, on our weight, on our depression, on our anxiety. All the list goes on and on and on. And we're so wrapped up with appointments, and I've got to get this done, I've got to focus on this, that we never even think outside of our little box to think about the person next to us that is alone and in need of hope and has never even heard the gospel. Right here in Jackson, Mississippi. So I want you to be mindful this week and as we leave of the people around us, or where you're putting your time, where I'm putting my time, where I'm putting my thoughts. You know, the times where I could be scrolling on my phone just saying, no, I'm going to spend this time praying for someone specifically. As we wrap up, Revelation 21, 4 through 8.
He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death.
So, as we were looking, that really went under hardship. I kind of got off on a little thing. But as we're speaking truth and sharing the gospel, we have to remember that one day Jesus is going to wipe away every tear. So whatever you're dealing with right now, I know that 10 out of 10 women are dealing with something, and I don't know that specifically. I know that God knows, and he cares, and I know that he's near the brokenhearted, and one day he will wipe every tear. I can't explain to you why you may be going through that, but I know that God is aware of it, and he knows the future, and he has a purpose for it, but we just have to trust him in the in-between and trust him and give that to him and know that one day we're not going to be here anymore. There's not going to be any more COVID. I don't ever want to hear that word again in heaven, or sickness or war or people suffering or all these sad stories on our Facebook newsfeed. I don't ever want to hear Facebook again in heaven either, because I want to escape it all. Don't you? Do you ever feel that? You just want to get away from it all. You just want peace and joy, and we're going to have that. We're not going to have it here, ever. Only in Jesus are we going to have that. The world is never going to offer us that. But one day, there's going to be none of that. But don't you want as many of your neighbors and your friends and your coworkers and your family members with you, celebrating in heaven for all of eternity? I know that I do. And sometimes it just takes me remembering and kind of reeling myself back in and saying, okay, Lord, help me focus on the things that matter. Help me to smile, to speak truth in love, to model Christ, to insert yourself into people's lives, to laugh, and to embrace hardship. I think that is how we change the world, one life at a time. But let's pray. God, thank you so much for your grace and for your love for us. Even though we are so undeserving of it, you love us. So God, help us to just walk in that and to do everything we do out of that love, and to know that you're with us. And as we study your word, and as we surround ourselves with believers, and as we pray and we call on you and your power, you work in us to accomplish exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we could ask or think. And it's according to your power that is at work within us. It's not us. So God, help us to deny ourselves. God, reveal things in our hearts, those weeds that have been there for far too long. God, I pray that you would reveal them and we would repent of them, and you would take them, and you would throw it far away, God, and we would fix our eyes on you, and that we would continue chasing after you, God, with everything that is in us, so that when we do finish this race, I mean, we are just falling over the line, and we are leaving it all on the field, God. I pray you would use us to make an impact in our workplaces, in our with the people that we come into contact with at restaurants, or the person who does our hair, or all these people that we see every single day that you've put into our lives for a very specific purpose. Help us to not just see it as a, you know, an acquaintance, but God, that we would be bold and we would speak truth. We wouldn't fear things being awkward or uncomfortable. We would know that, Lord, you're preparing their hearts, and we are just to be obedient in speaking your word. So God, help us, give us your power. I pray that you would bring people to mind that we can pour into, younger girls that we can invest in. And Lord, I pray we would make a difference in this world. I pray that we would love our husbands, we would love our children, grandchildren, our friends, our coworkers. We would love them and serve them in the name of Jesus. And I pray against the enemy's attack on the ladies in this room, Lord. I know he wants to steal and kill and destroy and distract us from our purpose, distract us from your love for us, your plan for us. But God, I pray against that. I pray you would keep us focused on you, and that you would sustain us, and that we would come humbly before you every day, just thankful that we can have a relationship with you. We love you so much, and it's in your holy name I pray. Amen. Well, thank y'all for coming tonight.
Thank you. But as you gather your stuff next Wednesday night, we are bringing back some family like supper. It's going to be a fun FBJ fair night. So from 5 to 6, we are offering some fair food, some hot dogs and hamburgers and chicken on a stick and some fun stuff. We're going to be able to spread out and do some outside eating to be safe and do it in a very organized and wonderful way for our families. But we'll be sending out some information. So as you're gathering your stuff, I just wanted to mention that. So we will have a family dinner next week.
What's
that?